to their futures. Soldiers speak out.
Welcome to the Veterans Hour, a monthly program for Veterans for Peace, Chapter 109, the Rachel Corey chapter in Olympia, Washington. And with me tonight is Mark Fleming. Normally, Mark and I aren't always in front of the camera, are we, Mark?
Yep, we're usually on the other side.
Other side. But tonight we have some very important things to share. Why don't you sort of introduce the type of things that we'll try to cover tonight?
Well, tonight we're talking about the transition that Veterans for Peace 109 and a sister organization, GI Voice, are making. Over the past few years, the nature of our work has changed. And more recently, GI Voice, which had organized outside, had a coffee house outside of Joint Base Lewis-McChord, closed that down and moved to Olympia, and is now looking at more organizing in various parts of the state rather than directly outside of Fort Lewis. In addition, Veterans for Peace, we started about 6 years ago doing veterans benefit counseling, started at Coffee Strong.
And you are an accredited VA claims agent.
As are you.
And so, we're both independent. And Let's tell our viewing audience, what does that really mean?
Well, the fact that we're accredited agents means that we can file claims on behalf of veterans.
Yes.
We function very much like an attorney. We've taken a test done by the VA and passed that, which means that we have the adequate knowledge. We've also studied the information, so we know the system. And what we can, probably our most important job is helping veterans navigate it. A lot of times they can actually do it themselves, but they don't know the system, they don't know how it works, they don't know what is necessary to put together a case. So we can help them do that. And in some cases where they have difficulty finding information, we can show them a way to get the information.
And we are independent.
Right.
And the reason we stress that is there are claims agents, but they are often tied to law firms.
Mm-hmm.
And we have found in the past, Mark, correct me if I'm wrong, but many times the veteran doesn't get their claim until it's denied.
Right.
Then the law office says, oh, we will file a notice of disagreement, and then they can start charging.
Right.
Because the initial claim, you cannot charge.
Right.
For it.
There's
don't charge at all for any of it, but neither can the law offices until it's denied.
So it's much more of an incentive for attorneys to focus on claims that pay them back. We take the claims early on, help them put them together, and if we do a really good job, it doesn't get denied, they get their benefits. And that's the most important thing. And because we no longer have the site at Coffee Strong, we've looked for alternatives. And one of the big changes that we had over the past year is Dennis and I were working with Sidewalk here in Thurston County on their homeless veterans program. And in the course of that, people identified homeless veterans who can't come into Olympia. How do you reach them? And one of the volunteers there donated a motorhome to us that we are now in the process.
A 28-foot motorhome.
Yeah. That we are refurbishing and are going to use it as a mobile office and take that out to different parts of the county.
Matter of fact, we call it a veteran mobile outreach.
Correct. So we'll use that working with, say, Sidewalk, with the Veterans Hub in Lacey to identify some locations, some places where we could go and give veterans a little bit more access. In addition, our work at Sidewalk has given us the opportunity to train on some of the other programs, and one of them is the housing program and the vulnerability index.
The vulnerability index is because today, homeless individuals, particularly homeless veterans that we're concerned about, get services based on how vulnerable are they, both medically and financially, just a variety of situations, but there has to be a scoring system, and it's very, very confidential. And
what kind of questions do they have?
Do you owe money to anyone?
Mm-hmm.
Does anyone think you owe money?
I think there's one. Does anyone care? Would anyone care if they knew that you were on the street tonight? So we get a set.
Yeah, we get some very sensitive questions, and we've been trained to gather this information, and then we turn that in for scoring. They come up with a vulnerability index score, which is used by a variety of the different agencies, particularly in Thurston County where we're located, and they use that to help them with their housing.
Right.
But one of the things that we learned about is veterans are in a unique position to have some funds that can help provide some stability in their housing.
Right. In fact, that, I mean, veterans who have honorable discharges have a wide array of benefits. Health care, educational benefits. If they have a disability connected to their service, they can receive monthly compensation. Mm-hmm. There's vocational rehab. So a lot of these, you know, many homeless people who are not veterans don't have access to this. Veterans do have the access, and by working with them, we can help them. That's one resource that they would have that can help them end their homelessness.
Now, Mark, we're soon to have some help come in by a gentleman who served at the Iraq conflict, Eric Ard. And he is studying to become an accredited claims agent, but he's going to specialize in discharge upgrades. Majority of the calls that we're getting in now for GI Voice
are for discharge upgrades.
Discharge upgrades, because they cannot get the benefits that they have rightfully earned.
And we have the same thing with some of the homeless vets.
Yes, and so Eric is going to spend his time doing that. And later on in this program, you're going to hear from Eric out at the place that has been donated to us. Tell us about that.
Well, that's a property in Northwest Phoenix. It's a 5-acre
Phoenix.
Whoa, I'm flashing back to
home.
You're
from the Phoenix area.
in Northwest Olympia.
Yes.
Where it's much wetter. Where we have a house that we can use as an office. We have our computers there. We're sharing the office with GI Voice, which is the sister organization, which Eric will talk about a little bit later. And it gives us an opportunity to have a place to set up. We can store it. We store the motorhome there. We'll be using that as a place to repair the mobile home. And it gives us a location. It's not necessarily a place where veterans would necessarily come in. You know, we're more likely to go out to the veterans. But this gives us a central place to keep our files, keep them under lock and key, and ensure that it maintains
confidentiality. And we have the internet there, so mm-hmm. we can get information. The telephone, we return the calls in.
Yeah.
And as we mentioned, a good majority of those calls starting to come in now are, I didn't get the best discharge when
right.
I got out. And I don't think this is fair.
And that's something we should explain to the audience. A discharge upgrade is for a veteran that got a bad what was called a bad paper discharge, a less than honorable. There are whole categories of discharges. Most people are familiar with honorable discharges, which means you served well, your country appreciates that, you're entitled to all benefits. And then it kind of steps down all the way down to a dishonorable discharge, which means they don't even consider you a veteran. What we've found in many cases, veterans were railroaded out of the service. I certainly saw that in Vietnam when I was clerk. We processed a lot of people out, gave them administrative discharges. At the time, they didn't care. They just wanted out. Now, you know, they're missing out on benefits. So is there anything about the process that was wrong? Is there something that was missing? And one of the things that's typically been missing, particularly with older vets, is, you know, back in 1970 and the 80s, PTSD was not recognized. And very often, PTSD figures prominently in the behaviors that leads veterans.
Yes, they have cognitive issues, anger yeah. issues, sleep issues. They could be falling asleep on the job yeah. and then be written up for it.
And most recently, Secretary of Defense Chuck Hagel issued a directive to the Boards for Correction of Military Records, which is where you apply to say, this discharge is not right, here's why. He's asked these boards to liberally consider claims that involve PTSD, to look at the record and look at the diagnosis and see, was this a willful, persistent behavior that was could be explained by something other than just total disregard for military courtesy and law?
And sometimes they're given the soldiers at the time were given orders that were very questionable at the time, and if you questioned the order, you could be written up, given mm-hmm. Article 15, as it's called in the military
yep.
justice system. And if you get so many of those, you know, you're being dismissed for the good of the service.
Yeah. And it's, you know, it's been a problem throughout, but it was particularly evident during the height of the Iraq War, where you had people who are really good soldiers. They had a good record, distinguished service. They went to Iraq, they served, they came back disturbed. What they saw, what they did, and they did not adjust well. So they come back, now they can't, they're missing formation, they're getting meds that leave them half buzzed out, they can't perform their duties. It's like Dennis said, they'll get written up, they'll get an Article 15, and sooner or later their command will decide, you know, this person isn't meeting our needs, we don't want him. He gets kicked out.
So sign this paper and out you go. Yeah. And many times, you mean I can get rid of all the pain that I'm experiencing? Yeah. Let me sign. And out they go. And it's only later that they find out I've really been messed over right. with.
And very often you'll see a checklist with all, they signed off on everything saying, yes, I acknowledge this, I know this. But very often they're just signing it. They just want to be done with it and out.
Yes.
So it's doing a discharge upgrade is hard. You know, we've done
well, and thankfully Eric Art is going to be specialized in that. And we've been trained so that we can do that, but we really would have to study the materials to do that, and it's time consuming. Mm-hmm. It's not a quick fix. But if you were affected in somehow by your military service, and now you need to get veterans benefits. There's both the mental health side as well as the physical side. Mm-hmm. And some of the more common ones that we come across that is relatively easy to find, what's probably the number one easiest one to get?
Easiest one. I sometimes think PTSD, if you have the documentation.
Yeah.
Sometimes that can be difficult. Were you thinking of some other ones? Oh, the tinnitus, yes. Particularly for people who served in combat situations around small arms fire, aircraft, generators.
Generator noises.
Anything that makes noise.
Aircraft engines, shipboard noises.
Right. So very often you can talk to a vet and say, well, do you have any hearing problems? Well, I can hear pretty well. I said, well, do you have any ringing in your ear? Well, yeah.
Or buzzing.
Buzzing.
Isn't that normal?
and suddenly you realize, no, it's not normal. And you can get a 10% rating. That's the max you can get. What it does for you, though, is it automatically qualifies you for hearing aids. So you can improve your hearing. So tinnitus is simple.
And basically, you need to go to an audiologist. If you can't afford to go to an audiologist, you can request the VA. Mm-hmm. We call the 800 number, 827-1000. Yeah. You tell them that you're a veteran. You tell them the branch that you served in and that you want to be called in for testing by an audiologist.
And they will do that.
And they'll do that. It doesn't cost, you know, and you either are going to a local VA medical facility or it's outsourced to several VES or QTC or two outsourced groups. And they will test. And there, can they test for the buzzing and ringing that we hear?
I don't think so.
There's no test. But they can never hear it. So how does the veteran establish that?
By pointing out that I have this, here are the circumstances that in which I served. And I think that's about
yeah,
it.
Yeah, and saying I'm sick and tired of this buzzing ringing in the ears. I have to turn on the television or the radio program so there's always some noise so I can go to sleep. Yeah.
Now, it doesn't always work because, like, if you were in the infantry, you know, that sounds pretty straightforward. You've got the gunfire, the weaponry, the aircraft. So that's pretty simple. But we had one veteran who was a medic, and he served around generators, and he's tried several times.
Yeah, he was in Kuwait. Yeah, but thankfully he kept good records.
Yeah.
And yeah, he was around the generator noise 24/7. It also affected his hearing loss, which is a little harder to prove that it's service connected.
And I know we had the claim in. Is that still pending?
Still pending on that one, but he did get the tinnitus.
Okay.
And that gives him roughly, $137 today?
Mm-hmm.
And that's monthly, and it'll always stay.
It won't get worse.
It won't get worse. Television may say there's a program that you may get better. It's questionable. But at least that's one type of a claim. It gets your foot in the door. You're going to get a VA credential that you can do. But then you can amend the claim later on, just saying, oh, but wait, there's more. And how do we know that there's more? We have a document that we've created.
Yes. And the woman who trained us said, you need to interview these vets from head to toe.
So that's what we did. So we created a document.
So we start at the head thinking, okay, brain trauma, neck problems, eyes, going on the shoulders, extremities, lungs, abdomen, all the way down to the toes. And what we do is we ask the vet, you know, we'll either run through it with them or have them go through it and say, well, list out all the things that are...
It's about 8 pages, too.
Yeah, that you have. When we first started doing this, we would have a veteran with 17 different conditions, and we made the mistake of actually putting in for 17.
And about a year later...
If you put in for that, you have to provide the evidence and realize that that's pretty time-consuming. What we finally did is, you know, we identify all the conditions, and then talk to the veteran and say, well, what concerns you most? We can also look at it in terms of what's going to provide the greatest relief to the veteran. Can you get more? Like, if all I can do is tinnitus, he's just going to get $130 a month.
Right.
But if he has, you know, back problems, knee problems, I mean, it could be that he could get 100% and disability, which is something like $3,000 a month.
But, you know, if the person is an older veteran, I mean, obviously you can tell
like
from
us,
our hair color, like us, we're older veterans. And we served in the 60s and 70s. So if you get a veteran that's low income, was a veteran, they can prove they're a veteran, they can show their income level and their basically their age.
Right.
They can get a non-service connected pension.
And that's based on income.
Yes.
It's about $12,000 a year currently.
Which, you know, if you think of the homeless veterans that we see coming through and we used to see coming through sidewalk, we can spend maybe 3 months to 9 months trying to get them disability benefits. But if we can say, are you, you know, how old are you? You know, and then we can you show us your verification of your income? We can probably get them that pension a lot quicker.
Now, one limitation is that they'll count income. So if the person is already receiving SSI and might be getting $900 a month, he'll get the extra $100.
$1,200 or something, so that they
have. So it's only the difference, because you only get so much. But still, it's something that they did not have before.
And the one thing about having a disability benefit is it's non-taxable according to the IRS. Now, it still counts as sort of what is your income when you go for housing,
right,
type of thing. But when it comes to filing taxes, the IRS does not count that as taxable income.
And now you mentioned a non-service connected pension.
Yes.
You could also point out what a service connected pension is.
Ah, let's do that.
Yeah, because we talked about, and what that is, it's a disability pension based on something that happened to you in the service. So a good example would be you lost a leg. Okay, there was an event that occurred. You lost your leg in the line of duty. And that gives you, like, that one's pretty simple, because, and you currently have that disability because your leg didn't grow back.
And you can get a diagnosis saying, yes,
yeah,
you do have a missing limb.
So by combining what happened, what you have now, and clearly there's a link. And there are three things that are used to establish a claim. And that's one of the things that we do with the veterans is educate.
And that's where the hardest part is for veterans getting veterans benefits, for the actual money coming through on a monthly basis, mm-hmm, is the, I don't understand. This process looks pretty complicated. And I've heard friends, they get it denied and then they give up.
Now, that can happen. I mean, when we first started, it was taking close to a year to get a veteran, a new claim through. And that was a big scandal. And VA put a lot of resources into doing that. And now I think it's down to less than 6 months.
Yes.
Now, one of the ways they did that was they pulled everybody and his dog to do the claims, meaning other things didn't get done, like appeals. And I just did an appeal last week that I started 6 years ago. We filed for the appeal 3 years. It took 3 years to get.
3 years to even get on the docket. Yeah.
So that's the next level. But still, it takes your time, do it carefully, you can get it done. And I think the key thing, the hardest part is like, okay, I'm a veteran, I'm coming in, I know I have this problem. What I need to do is say, well, what happened in service? And can I prove it?
Yeah.
And very often...
What was the event that happened in the service?
And very often, there may not be a record of that.
Oh.
Yeah.
Because they're out, like you were out in the bush somewhere
right.
In Vietnam. You're sort of like, stop, I need to go in and see the medic.
No, my medic was right there and he gave me antibiotics.
Yeah. Or other GI candy, you know, soldier on.
And even when I went to the battalion surgeon and had the arm lanced, there's nothing in my record to show that.
No. So, yeah, I mean, and if you started going all the time that something was wrong, they would label you as malingering.
Yes.
And then you discharge.
So the idea is you really, if you're currently a vet in service, you know, you need to keep your, you know, get a good record of what's going on. If you're injured, make sure it's noted somewhere. And even if it's not on your record, document it as best you can.
And, you know, we call it often a buddy statement.
Yeah.
You know, if you're injured today, there's email. We didn't have email when we were there. So it was a letter maybe weeks or a month later where something happened and we would share that. But today, you know, you're a telephone call away or an email away and you can say, this is what happened to me. You know, and so they can note that down. I'm working with a veteran today and helping with their claim where his wife says, oh yeah, I've got all the emails and letters, you know, and then I also can tell what happened and how different he was when he came home.
And that's a good piece of evidence there, particularly if you're looking at somebody dealing with PTSD, a family member or a friend who knew the veteran before the veteran went into combat and after combat, they can say, well, this is what my friend was like before, this is what my friend is like now, here's how it's different. You know, we're not asking someone to diagnose a veteran. What we're asking is that the veteran, that the person say, here's what I observed, here's what I saw. You know, anybody can make that kind of a statement.
And to make that even more concrete, we've developed a form which we call a sworn statement. We say pursuant to USC, and we list the title of the 28. I swear under penalty of perjury. Now, why is that important, Mark, that the VA sees that language?
Because that is a much, you know, the veteran is saying, you know, I am swearing, I recognize that I am liable for penalties under the law if I make a false statement. And when we talk to veterans
about... That's a prison sentence.
So when we talk to veterans about this, they're saying, you know, we're going to ask you to swear to this. So think about what you're saying and make sure that, you know, that this is true.
And if it's... The gold standard is, here's my medical service records, my medical records, and I don't have very many, and you may not have very many, but we can write a sworn statement that... On 1968, such and such a date, you know, I had a hard parachute jump and I was injured, you know, and yes, they gave me Motrin 800 and said, soldier on. But now x-rays are showing that I had a fractured back as a result. But a sworn statement, if it's not in the medical records, can say, this is what happened to me. Or you have the case of the person who is traumatized.
And we
say like a moral injury. When they come home and that's not the person that went off to service.
And it's also, you don't necessarily have to make this claim immediately after discharge. We have seen any number of veterans well after the fact, Vietnam veterans 30, 40 years after the fact, who've come in who are beginning to... are suffering from PTSD. Maybe they've always had it. In 2003, after the Iraq War, a lot of Vietnam veterans suddenly began having PTSD because they were seeing much of the same thing they saw in Vietnam. We had one case of a veteran who came in, had never filed a claim, but was able to articulate, here's what's happening with me now. And here's what I did. In this case, he was a door gunner on a helicopter and flew 150 missions. There was no record in his service, or no, in a service record of this. But you know, he could point out that he served in this company. He did a statement of here's what happened then, here's what's going on now. He got buddy statements. We filed it, and he got I think it was about a 40% rating after close to 40 years.
Well, and he had a veteran too that was in the Navy. Now we're both Army, and so we have sort of a stereotype of.
Oh, Navy? What do they do?
Yeah, Navy, or you were in the Chair Force, as we used to call the Air Force. But, hey, they served too and were in mm-hmm. situations that affected them. In this case, a Navy person had a North Vietnamese shell go into the vehicle or the
side of their destroyer,
the destroyer that he was, cut a hole in it, but it landed up actually killing three of his bunk mates.
And he got to clean them up.
And he had to clean the parts up and then refrigerate the body parts. Now, he kept very quiet, became very dependent upon alcohol, and went through one or two wives afterwards because of his PTSD, but just suffered, you know, silently about it. But where was the record, you know? Because he didn't go see a Navy corpsman on that. However, we actually went over to the ship records.
Yeah.
We saw a picture. Oh my gosh, they took a picture of that ship being towed back to Hawaii for repairs.
And in this case, we had the ship's log. So we had, you know, we knew on a certain date, you know, they said we were attacked. We had this many injured. We had, I think one was killed. Several were evacuated. One died later. So we had the evidence of what happened.
And they were the names of the people that he said, these were my best shipmates and my buddies who were bunkmates.
So.
And he had survivor's guilt, too, because he chose to go on duty away from where the shell hit. But we were able to show this as documentation, and that led to him getting permanent disability benefits.
Correct. So there are ways to do it. And what we've discovered over the past 6 years that we've been doing this is we've gotten a lot better at it.
Well, let's cycle back to GI Voice. What they do, because that's a little different than what we do, because we are sort of an outreach of Veterans for Peace 109, the Rachel Corey chapter here in Olympia, Washington. There's not many of us in Veterans for Peace that are doing that. We want to encourage other chapters who may be watching that you can do this too. Mm-hmm. But GI Voice is sort of a unique one because it came from the Coffee Strong days.
Yeah. The
coffee house movement. We had GIs coming in from, and it was a great location. They would come into the coffee house, and we would share information. We always would say, here's things that you could do. We'd never say, you need to do this. We would lay out sort of, here are some different strategies that you can do.
But it was evident early on that, you know, the veterans benefit, which was kind of a side effort for GI Voice, because they set up the coffee house as part of the
resistance,
anti-war pro GI resistance.
But we came in more from we could help with veterans benefits too.
And we supported GI Voice and Coffee Strong, and we also get, you know, here's something else that we can do for them. So it worked out pretty well.
And after a while, that coffee shop, you know, they were spending more time training baristas than trying to meet the needs of the veterans that either came in or the active duty personnel. Mm-hmm. And there was sort of a trickling off over a period of time as well. Right. Then they moved next door, and you'll see a picture of that one, where we had a very, very large facility, but it also came as an expense, too.
Right.
About $1,700 we were spending monthly.
It
was huge. And, you know, we want to thank the donors that made it possible to do that. But after a number of years, we said, you know, we can scale back. And so we moved to Olympia, and we got an office in downtown Olympia. We saved a lot of money, but it was still between $400 and $700 a month coming in there. And after about a year's time, this property became available. A very generous member of VFP donated it. You know, we
made it available to us.
$1 a year. Yeah. Well, that's a significant savings there. So we're sharing the expenses of the internet and the phone type of thing, but that then becomes a place where we can continue on the mission of both GI Voice as well as Veterans for Peace. It's become quite a very good location and a hub that we can continue our work. Very shortly, we'll have our vehicle ready with signage on it so that we can go. We have a friend, Kyle Lucas, who said, oh, you should contact the different tribes in the area because they also served, you know, and you could help, you know, provide mm-hmm. services. So there's at least three different Indian nations in this area that we could go as well.
So that's in addition to, you know, getting the motorhome ready to go, we're starting to reach out to the community to find out, okay, where is it we should go with this? Where can we take this?
Well, and, you know, and recently, Mark, we just applied through Veterans for Peace National Office for a Howard Zinn grant. And one of the things that they liked about the project, not just that we were doing independent VA claims agents and going where the veterans were, but we are starting to network through the community. We have a community sustaining fund.
Here in Olympia,
we have different faith communities that have helped donate for this project. And then over in Lacey, we have the Veterans Hub, which we sincerely hope that
the city of Lacey
continues to fund that, because it's providing a very essential mm-hmm. source. For us, they tell us where veterans are. For instance, if we go out to Rochester or Yelm or so, we don't know those areas, but they know in the Veterans Hub some of the places that we could go park the vehicle, put out our sign.
Give us some contacts to help us.
And then we can fill out these forms, and then we can fax those. We appreciate Sidewalk having the fax. We have a fax mm-hmm. also on the property in West Olympia now. So that, you know, provides a real output for us.
So we have have the opportunity to expand. Like when we first started this at Coffee Strong, it seemed like we were drinking from a fire hose, because we had veterans coming in. We'd have five or six over a period of 4 hours every time we came in.
Yes.
And now that we're no longer located right by the base, that's really dropped off. So now what we're trying to do is think, well, if they're not, we don't have a single place where they can come to us, how can we come to them?
And we are seeing some that we served before. We had some 132 yep. people that we had claims on in various states of, you know, is this active? Is this pending? Is this no longer? Mm-hmm. But, you know, some we all of a sudden, can you help me? Like, we haven't seen this person in a year. And so, you know, we're processing that.
And that's part of the how the process works. We'll get a veteran will come in, and then we don't see or hear from them for a while, and then they come back. So it's, we can't go chasing everybody, but if a veteran comes in and accesses us, we can certainly we can do it for them in some cases. But most often, we like to try to get them to do, be their own advocate. We can explain the process, show them what's needed. They're the ones that would know who they can talk to get buddy statements, what records they have, mm-hmm. and we can show them how to get the additional records. So there's a lot that a veteran can do on their own with some help.
Well, and one of the things that I've appreciated at Sidewalk here in Olympia is that on Thursdays, which we often called our Veterans Day there, mm-hmm. we had a number of the intake people that we were able to in service. And so
they were veterans.
And so we basically shared, here's the type of things that you can do mm-hmm. and process those things.
Now, also one key thing about this whole operation is it costs money to do.
Yes.
So we have done some crowdfunding. We sought some grants. We think it's going to cost about $10,000 to put, you know, get the vehicle in shape and then operate it for the first year. So if you are inclined, you can donate. And where would they donate?
Well, they could write for Veterans for Peace, 109, and a simple mail address would be 804 Narnia Lane Northwest, and that's in Olympia, 98 502. And we can then deposit that check. You'll get a tax receipt from that one. And so,
in our eternal gratitude.
Oh, indeed. So those things make it possible. We would encourage you now just to sit back and watch the video clip that Mark and I did earlier today when we interviewed Eric Ard and discussed a little bit about what's happening at the property and took some videos of where the motorhome is
and
stored.
A bit more about GI Voice. He speaks in a little bit more detail.
And he speaks more detailed about GI Voice.
GI Voice has gone through several locations. It started as... I'm not doing this right.
We started as a coffee house, and we're following the coffee house model from the Vietnam War. That's what a lot of, right. There were originally, I think, like four around in the U.S. during the Iraq War. I think something like that. And Coffee Strong was, I'm not sure it was the first, but it was the last one to close.
Mm-hmm.
And one of the things that people discovered was that model didn't really work with this generation of soldiers. This is being a professional army as opposed to a conscript army. So we started out one way and then morphed into more of what we're talking about now.
Absolutely. The GI Voice started with a coffee house model that was based on a Vietnam model that started with the UFO coffee house in South Carolina. A local representation of that was the Half Shelter in Tacoma, Washington. Those organizations were excellent at providing a space for veterans to have conversations outside of their chain of command. And correct, we did have some very, very good successes with that model when Coffee Strong was at the height of its operating capacity. There were several other GI Voice coffee houses across the United States and in Germany, most notably the Clearing Barrel in Germany and Under the Hood in Texas near Fort Hood. All of those coffee shops are now defunct. At Coffee Strong, we had an up-close look at why that model became less and less relevant for ourselves personally. We found that the crux of our organizing was around important critical services to veterans in need. And as a result, when faced with the decision between maintaining the coffee shop and maintaining services, we went with services. In pursuit of maintaining services, we found that we didn't need as much material overhead as we did at the coffee shop. So we have been shrinking our operational overhead to match our operational needs, and that has meant smaller and smaller locations. The location we're at now in West Olympia will take the least amount of donor funds to do more than has been done with donor funds, any amount of donor funds we receive so far. So we're doing more with much more with much less at this moment. Right now, this house houses both Veterans for Peace 109 Rachel Corey chapter and GI Voice. Our mobile veteran outreach program, which is a program in partnership with GI Voice and VFP, is our 28-foot RV that is capable of mobile. Our 28-foot RV that is capable of delivering mobile services to vulnerable veterans is housed on this property, as well as our daily operational functions.
And talk a little bit about what GI Voice has in mind for in the near future. So you've said services, or excuse me, organizing, other plans, groups you're working with?
Absolutely. Our veterans services were always a shared joint project between GI Voice and Veterans for Peace. GI Voice is looking to expand the types of works it's doing, but it's due to long-term caseloads and a long-existing partnership. GI Voice is a partner with Veterans for Peace in launching the Mobile Veteran Outreach Center. However, that will not be a primary function of GI Voice anymore. It will sustain itself along with the efforts of Veterans for Peace. GI Voice is right now looking, developing programming and developing content for low-powered radio, and we will be expanding our media reach through low-power radio in Portland and Olympia. We will be releasing educational PSAs on TCTV, closed-circuit television, and all of that stuff will be cross-referenced with our social media to really start educating the true cost of war and getting the message out.
And I guess that brings up, you know, so what is the purpose? What are you trying to accomplish with this?
With the new programs?
Yeah.
Absolutely. What we're looking to do is that we are now in an upswell of veteran interest throughout the United States in light of the Trump presidency and other political realities in the Middle East and Africa. And we are positioning ourselves to be able to elevate the voice of veterans and to get veterans and active duty soldiers information in regards to their own rights so that they can advocate for themselves and cover down on their buddies while in the service and navigating that transition to the civilian world.
I know, you know, during my generation in Vietnam, there was a very active resistance within the military. Do you see any possibility for the current with the professional army?
Where we're at right now, there is not a lot of above ground resistance within the ranks. That's due to several factors, most of which being that our deployment levels have dropped dramatically since 2008. And we are an all-volunteer force now. However, with the new administration change in government, we could see a lot of people who recently came into the Army under the premise that Don't Ask, Don't Tell was fully out of effect or that trans rights were going to be respected. We were also hearing from drone pilots and that PTSD doesn't just happen in large deployments, but it can happen happen with an Xbox controller in your hand and sitting in the interior United States somewhere.
Right. We've served veterans with that exact same problem.
Absolutely. And we're also come to find out that, according to a new study that I believe you might have shown me, that moral injury has been determined to be indistinguishable from PTSD from a medical perspective. So the idea that we were catching everyone now is an obsolete idea, and there's a whole generation of people who don't know that they're entitled or that they need services. Mm-hmm. So there, we can expect an upswell as that idea becomes more accepted.
So really, and I know a lot of what GI Voice had done in the past was it wasn't so much direct resistance as just telling veterans what it is, you know, what their rights are, you know, what their options are. Is there any plans for that in the future?
Absolutely. There's literature that's already being developed and that will be available. We always have the GI Rights Network that we can plug into, and groups such as the Military Law Task Force. We can help people at any level. If a soldier or service member just needs something administrative tasking such as their medical claims filed, then we can handle those sort of things. If it escalates higher and they need help, then we have very large networks that we developed under the banner of Coffee Strong that we can still tap into.
And certainly speaking out as a veteran gives you you have a valid, credible voice to speak about war. It's not just all veterans are gung-ho waving the flag. Many realize what the problems they incur, the kinds of policies that they're being asked to pursue and are not comfortable with that. So providing that kind of, not so much telling they have to resist, but asking them or giving them information about what their options are, what they can do. And then more particularly, you know, once veterans are out, what is it they can do to pursue their own interests as well as social justice? I mean, mm-hmm. Like you came out with a very strong sense that this is wrong.
Absolutely.
And you found GI Voice is a good good vehicle for following that. I guess, would you recommend, is there anything you could say or recommend to veteran, you know, people who are about to become veterans who are currently serving, what GI Voice can do for them or how they might benefit from services?
Absolutely. I will say that it's something that a renowned maybe infamous veteran Chris Hedges said, wrote a whole book about it, and that's that war is a force that gives you meaning. I think a lot of veterans come out of the service not feeling like they've found their meaning. And I would like to reiterate that whether it was a positive or a negative experience, it was a powerful experience, and you can carry over the skills you've had and carry over the lessons learned, even if they were hard learned. And there's a lot you can do with us on the civilian side. If your service left you for want in some area of your life, if you felt like you joined up to protect people or to make the world a better place, and you did, we're not qualified to help with that sort of paperwork. If you'd like, I can take your information and I can find out who has those services and get back to you through email. Okay, can I please get your email?
Well, and this is an example of a typical call coming in to GI Voice. And some of the things we can handle, others we need to refer them on.
Currently, I am training to take the Veterans Affairs Advocacy Test. I have been studying for two months now, and I will be taking that test within the next 2 months. Once I have passed it, it will give me a lot more leeway to help veterans in the way I really want to. I am planning to plug in with Dennis and Mark's great work in the Veteran Mobile Outreach Vehicle, and I will be making discharge upgrades a focal point for myself. It's a need that a lot of veterans have, and rarely gets addressed.
And it seems to be a need that's particularly critical among homeless veterans. As Dennis and I have worked with Sidewalk here in Olympia, we have seen any number of homeless vets who have bad conduct and other than honorable discharges, and it prevents them from accessing services.
Yes, and to say our services directly interact with homeless services and rapid housing services, and whenever we're able to get a small discharge upgrade, it can make a huge impact on services available, including back pay money all the way through the levels of rapid housing that they're eligible for. So it's small amounts of paperwork can dramatically change a veteran's situation.
Look forward to you passing that test and joining us.
Yeah. Thank you. Eric, Mark and I are from the days of Vietnam, and there were things that happened to us that forever affected us and why we are now part of a greater cause of bringing world peace. How did you happen to join, and what forever changed you during that time, and how has it affected you and given you direction to what you're doing now?
Yeah, so I joined the military like a lot of people because I was disowned by one of my parents. It's a very common story in the military. It was a way for me to leave my house before I turned 18 without being homeless. Advice to anyone thinking about it, if you're trying to escape an authoritarian parent, the army is not different. So I started my military journey in 2002 when I was 17 years old. I signed up for the delayed entry program when my dad was away at work, with my mom signing as a signature when I was 17 on September 9th, 2001. 2 days later, the entire world changed forever. And there was nothing I could do about it at that point except be caught in those winds. I took up my service happily, and I completed my service with an honorable discharge. But in the course of my service, it became very apparent that the war in Iraq was morally unjustifiable. I spent my time in Iraq as a casualty liaison, working in a combat clinic in ICU, and my hands were the last hands that probably 20 or 30 soldiers felt overseas, and that changed me. That changed me forever. When I came home for leave a few years later, I came home to Pensacola Beach, which was completely destroyed by the Deepwater Horizon spill. And it was in the context of having my life and all both of my worlds, both professional and personal, crashed by the military industrial complex and big energy that standing on the beach in Pensacola, I realized that I would be addressing these issues for the rest of my life.
And that's not uncommon. I can say, you know, going to Vietnam had that same effect on me. Participating in a war that I knew was wrong has left that with me and carries forward to this day.
So absolutely.
You're right. It will be with you forever. This is one way of actually making something of it.
Absolutely. Finding the force that gives you meaning.
Yeah. And that's why I would say thank you for service now.
Well, thank you too.
Because that's the service you're providing to the country.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And it never ends.
That's right.
We want to also thank our viewing audience as well as Thurston Community Media for making this opportunity for us to record here in the studio and to share with you. And then it's shown on Channel 22 here on cable in Thurston County, but also on YouTube. So thank you for watching.
Not liars.